Hey, good morning, everybody. We're so glad you're here worshiping with us. Welcome to Dunwoody. Won't you stand and join us as we sing together? It's fallen from the clouds, a strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and rain. It's ringing in the skies like cannons in the night. The music of the universe plays. You are holy. We're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon galaxies is reaching far beyond the Milky Way. So let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it out as the music of the universe plays. You are holy, and we're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of you. And all glory, honor, power is yours. Amen. All glory, honor, power is yours. Amen. All glory, honor, power is yours. Forever. Singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. And I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of you, will sing of you. We're singing, you are holy, you're great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are. How great you are, oh God.
Thank you for your patience. Do you ever have trouble being patient with people? You have expectations, right? You have things that need to be done, especially now that school is in start. Maybe your work schedule is picking up. We have deadlines and things that have to get done. We want people to respect our time, all of those things, right? But sometimes there's more going on, and we don't always stop to listen. We don't always stop to figure out why people are doing what they're doing, why they aren't able to do what we need them to do. Sometimes we're not very good at giving people second chances. So this morning as we worship, let God stir your heart. Evaluate your expectations of others. How maybe you are good at listening, or maybe you haven't been so good at listening to others and their needs. But at this time, we'd like to invite you, as we continue on in worship, to turn and greet your neighbor in Christian love.
Let's continue in worship. Let's sing like David in the temple.
Like David in the temple, I want to bring you praise. Like David in his temple plans, your ways are not my ways. You don't need me to build a temple to know that you love me still. Oh. Like Israel on the shore, all I see is crashing waves. Like Israel on the shore, through the wild you make a way. I will go where you go, I will stay where you stay. Oh. Cause I don't wanna go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me. I don't want to go if you're not going before me.
Let's think like Moses.
Like Moses in the desert, I want to see the land. Like Moses in the desert, I can't fully see your plan. Still your love doesn't stop when I see the land from the mountaintop. Oh.
Like Peter.
Oh, like Peter on the hill, I want to make this my place. Hill for your transfigured face. I will go where you go, I will stay where you stay.
So you're all I've ever needed. Jesus in the garden, will you take this cup from me? Like Jesus in the garden, you don't call where you don't lead. I want to love like you love, I want to bleed like you bleed. That flows like a river, washing over. Fount of heaven, love of Christ, overflowing me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Set me free. Christ my Savior, rescued me. Take this life, deliver a vessel of your. Set me free, Christ my Savior, rescued me. Let's sing that again. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Set me Christ my Savior, rescued me.
Let's raise our voices together and sing, you've given me life and opened my eyes. And I love you, Lord. Here we go. You've given me life.
You've given me life. You opened my eyes. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. You've entered my heart. You set me. Christ my Savior, rescue.
Let's sing it again.
Thank you, Jesus. You set me free. Christ, my Savior, you rescued me.
Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we come to you this morning in worship. And we lay ourselves at your feet, knowing that you offer us new life abundantly. You've set us free. We praise you, and we thank you for the great measure of your love and for the redemptive power of your grace. Lord, with open hands, we offer all that we have back to you. We thank you for all your blessings and all your mercies, which you and your love have showered on us so gracefully. Lord, let us never forget who you are and whose we are. Let the miracle of your grace happen here and now as we worship and as we hear from your word. Give to us a still and quiet heart. Lord, give us ears to hear and eyes to see. Speak to us your truth that we may glorify you with our lives as an act of worship to you. Lord, at this time we also pray for the Ith family in our community on the death of their father and grandfather Ronald on August 4th. Bring peace and comfort to all those who love him. And we celebrate with Marianne and Brandon Williams after the birth of their son Joel on August 2nd. Be with the family as they begin a new chapter in their lives together. We thank you, Jesus, for setting us free and for rescuing us. And we ask that you meet us here this morning and reveal to us your heart, that we may remember your call and act in the ways of love and grace as you have done for us. We love you, Lord. And it's through Christ our Lord who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Good morning. Did I see the Culvers this morning? They're back there. They're new grandparents for like the 12th time. Asa Jackson was born out in Texas, so we rejoice with you as well today. I'm sure that name will be in the bulletin next week, but what a wonderful gift of new life. Friends, I don't know about you, but there are times when I start to see something everywhere. You're thinking about a new car, right? And you're thinking that maybe that new Genesis SUV, can I get a witness? Anybody? You think maybe that's the car that you need, and you've never really seen them on the road, and then you start thinking about getting one, and you start to see them everywhere. You look to your left at a stoplight, and there's one, and there's another one behind it. You find out that your boss's husband owns one. You find out that the neighbor across the street is test driving one. You just start to see it everywhere. They're ubiquitous. Everywhere you look, you turn on the Braves game, and there is an ad for the Genesis. It's just everywhere you look. You've never seen one before. Now you'll see them this week. It's called the Bader-Meinhof phenomena, or the frequency illusion. The Bader-Meinhof phenomenon basically says that those things were already there. Those things were already there, but until you started to look for them, you didn't see them. And I have to say that is true this week of figs. Has anyone else seen them? Figs are everywhere. Figs are everywhere. Everywhere I turn, figs, 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 figs. Everywhere I look, there have been figs. I went to the 48th Street Market this week, one of my favorites. And if you haven't been there, you need to go. It's a great way to get a simple summer supper. You just tell them to slice some thin lunch meat. It's better than lunch meat. It's like really fine Italian capicola and soprasetta. And my wife loves the mortadella. And then you get a fresh burrata, a loaf of bread, and add a tomato to that. You can't beat supper from 48th Street Market. Amen? Amen. How many of you have never been there? You got to go. It is well worth it. But when I went the other day, on the door was a sign that said $25 fig trees for sale. That's often what you think of when you go to an Italian market, that you're going to be able to buy a fig tree, and all the money goes to the USO. Go figure. Thank you. And then I talked to my wife, Elizabeth, and I said, you know, what'd you have for lunch at work on Monday? And she said, fig pie. I don't even know what is in a fig pie. I'm not sure I even want to know. And then I played in the church golf tournament on Tuesday. And while I was in the church golf tournament on Tuesday, what do you think the snacks were? Fig bars. Both strawberry and blueberry. Strawberry and blueberry fig bars were the dessert. Everywhere I look, there are figs, they're multiplying, and I'm losing control. They're just everywhere. I mean, figs everywhere you turn. And then Olivia Newton, John dies. Is that too soon? And maybe too soon. The fig Newton almost became the fig Shrewsbury. The fig Shrewsbury, because the Kennedy Biscuit Company back in 1891 would name their cookies after local towns near Cambridgeport, Massachusetts. And so they were arguing for the fig Shrewsbury, but luckily it came out to be the fig. And how many of y'all love fig Newtons? It's one of my wife's favorite, fig Newtons, as opposed to blueberry and strawberry. And then I was talking to my wife about the David Attenborough special on plants that I haven't seen all of, but she was describing this amazing, amazing tribe in India, and they take the roots of a certain tree, and they put it inside bamboo poles, and they create natural bridges across very difficult places to navigate there in India. And they create these beautiful bridges. One of the guys from NPR went and showed these amazing pictures of these natural bridges. And those are all made from the root of what tree? No, not the fig tree. The ficus tree. But figs come from ficus trees. We call it fig tree because that's just the kind of common name, but it's all a ficus tree. And those were from Ficus elastica. And you just would be amazed by those bridges that were able to connect people. And those natural bridges don't cost any money to make. They just take time. And in an area that is prone to earthquakes, they last longer than man-made bridges. They're able to also be a habitat for all sorts of things that are happening. So everywhere I look, there have been figs, figs, figs. And then Jesus comes in this passage to say, you better shape up, because I need a plant, and my heart is set on fruit. You better shape up. He has been talking to us in the 12th chapter. And in the 12th chapter, he's talking about reading the signs of the times and being able to understand what's going on in the world. And he says, well, how can you miss what's going on in the world? How can you miss the signs of the times when somebody breaks in with a terrible news flash? And that terrible news flash is about pilots terrible atrocity that he has perpetrated in the temple. What, in the 13th chapter of Luke, someone shows up. It's like one of those bad alerts on your phone. Do you get those where it's like, here's another shooting, here's another person being hurt, here's another accident? Those come to my phone all the time, and they're relentless. And this person shows up and says to Jesus, did you hear about what just happened in Jerusalem? Pilate killed the people who were offering sacrifice and mingled their blood with the blood of the sacrifice. A terrible, terrible scene. It would be like some of the things that have happened in churches and in synagogues in recent days. And it's one of the reasons we're putting together a safety team. I hate to have to do that. Never had to do that at any other church, to put together a safety team. But we live in those days. And if that's something you feel called to, I know that we'd be glad to talk to you to keep our children and to keep our church campus as safe as humanly possible. And when they hear this report, Jesus asks them, he says, do you think those people were worse sinners than anyone else? And then there's a story told about a natural disaster. It could be an engineering mishap. A tower falls and kills some people. And Jesus says, do you think those people were worse sinners? People who were killed intentionally? People who were killed accidentally? And what I think Jesus is trying to do is to separate how suffering is not always tied to our human sinfulness. Now, sometimes we do things that bring suffering. We've all done things that have brought suffering upon ourselves, amen? But what Jesus is trying to say is that much of human suffering is not the fault of the person who is suffering. I don't know about you, but I see some of the kindest, nicest people in the world who get cancer. Some of the kindest people that I know are the ones who suffer the most. And that's going to be one of my first questions when I get to see God. I'm going to be up there and I'm going to be like, I have a question for you. Why is it that some of the nicest, kindest, gentlest people I've ever met in my life are some of the people who get cancer? Not that I want mean people to get cancer. Please don't hear that. But I just wonder why so many people who are so nice and kind and gentle and faithful suffer the most. And Jesus is trying to tell them that that is not how things are. He says, you know, you really need to take a look at yourselves. Stop trying to put blame out there. Stop trying to put blame somewhere else. You need yourself to repent. You need to deal with your own stuff instead of someone else's. And that's when he turns to this parable of the fig tree. It's a very short story. It's just a few verses, but like the small fig, it's full of nourishment for us as we turn to the 13th chapter of Luke, beginning in verses 6 to 9. Hear the story that Jesus tells. Then Jesus told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came looking for fruit on it and found none. So he said to the gardener, "See here, for 3 years I've come looking for fruit on this tree, and still I find none. Cut it down. Why should it be wasting the soil?" But the gardener replied. He replied, "Sir, let it alone for one more year until I dig around it and put manure on it. If it bears fruit next year, well and good. But if not, you can cut it down." This is the good news according to the Gospel of Luke. Thanks be to God. It's a very short story. It's a very short story, and it really asks this question that Olivia Newton-John asks.
Do we deserve a second chance?
Do we deserve a second chance? Do you deserve a second chance? We love second chances for ourselves. Do we deserve a second chance? How did I fall into this circumstance? How did I get the rest of these fig pictures? How did we fall into this circumstance? It's a twist of fate. There it is. The gift, I never really listened to these words before. The gift of life extension by divine intervention. It's got to be a strange twist of fate. Olivia Newton-John asked those questions. Do we deserve a second chance? And when it's us, we deserve a second chance. You know that you deserve a second chance. But when it's other people, we are not quite as sure that they deserve a second chance. you know that there are people out there that will go on the golf course and they will take mulligans. Have you ever seen that? They will give themselves a second chance. They're not given a second chance. They're not given a mulligan. They will take a mulligan. They will take a second chance for themselves, because we all know we deserve a second chance. We're not exactly sure that other people deserve a second chance. Now, there's some things you shouldn't give a second chance to, as you might see in what John Daly does here in this video. John Daly has a little shtick. Well, it's not a little shtick. I would cry too if when you see this, you're going to cry or cringe. John Daly will invite someone to lay down on the ground. Garrett, would you want to? No, I'm kidding. Invite you to lay down on the ground. You put a tee in your mouth. You put a ball on that tee. And then John Daly comes and swings his driver and hits that ball out of your mouth. You ready? Take a look. Do you deserve a second chance? Yeah. Well, you get a second chance. That's good. But just imagine it. Just imagine John Daly, who may or may not be all together when he swings that club, and you just laying there. That is not something that should happen a second time. The landowner has had a tree planted. That landowner has had a tree planted, and when that landowner has a tree planted, he comes back year after year looking for fruit. The trouble with that is, from the research I've done, most fig trees don't begin to give fruit until years 4, 5, and 6. Some give fruit in year 3, but most don't give fruit until years 4, 5, and 6. So he has a fig tree planted, and he comes looking for fruit on it, and he doesn't find fruit for 3 years. He calls the gardener to him, and he basically yells at the gardener, and he says, See here, I have come looking for fruit 3 years in a row. I've looked at this thing for fruit for 3 years in a row, and I haven't found any fruit. Cut that thing down. It's a waste of soil. And I want to say to the landowner, maybe it's not time yet. Maybe it's not time yet. Maybe it's not ready to bear fruit, because you've come for the first 3 years and come to pass judgment. It's like that relative that comes once a year to your house and passes judgment. Does anybody have anyone like that? They just show up once a year and they're judgmental, and they leave for a year and then they come back at the next holiday. That's what this landowner seems to be like. And the gardener says to him, wait a second. Give me one more year. Give this plant a second chance. Wait. Will you just wait a second? And we're not good at waiting. We have a hard time waiting for a web page to load. We do not like to wait. And this landowner, he's the one who owns the whole vineyard, and the gardener says, wait. And I think when God tells us to wait, it's sort of an expectant waiting. It's not like just sitting here twiddling our thumbs, hoping that something might happen. It's more like the racers in a starting block. All that pent-up energy, and they are there, ready, set to go, and they're prepared for what is next. So it is an active waiting, and the gardener says, I'm going to do some active waiting. What I'm going to do in this intervening time is I'm going to dig around the roots. I'm going to dig around the roots, and then I'm going to throw some fertilizer on this plant, some manure on this plant, and I'm going to work at it so that growth can occur. Why is it that when people disappoint us, we are quick to cut them down? Why is it that when people don't meet our expectations, and sometimes they are heightened expectations, we're quick to turn to another and to cut them down? Or we're willing to cut them down right to their faces, as opposed to what the gardener does. The gardener says, there is a better way, because your heart is not the first heart broken. Your eyes are not the first to cry. There are other people who have are going through pain, and you might not know the whole story. And because you don't know the whole story, you may need to do some trowel work. You need to dig around the roots to try and find out more of what's going on. I know that's true for me. When people irritate me, there's sometimes I don't know their whole story. There may be something going on beneath the surface. And the more I can dig and excavate and try to understand them, the more I can understand why they're probably not bearing fruit at that moment. Stephen Covey tells the story that is one of my favorites about the assumptions that we made and don't really understand what people might be going through. He said it was a peaceful Sunday morning on the New York subway. Can you imagine? A peaceful Sunday morning on the New York subway. People were minding their own business. They were reading their papers. Some of them were napping on their way home from the late shift or the late show. And it was a peaceful morning when a man walked onto the subway train with his three kids. The man sat down next to Covey, and those three kids proceeded to run up and down the subway train, hanging on the bars, pulling people's newspapers, and generally just annoying everyone on the train. Covey thought, this guy is going to have to do something about these kids. But those kids kept on, and everybody was getting so irritated. And so he decided in the nicest, kindest way that he could, he turned to the fellow and said, you need to do something about your kids. And the fellow looked like he'd awoken from sleep. And he said, oh, you may be right. You may be right. You see, we just came from the hospital, and their mother died an hour ago. And I don't know what to do or say, and I guess they don't either. Sometimes when people don't meet our expectation, instead of grabbing our axe and cutting them down with our words, we might need to do some digging to further understand who they are, to reveal a bit more of who they are, to help them to be more vulnerable and to open up so that we could possibly help. Through our youth ministry, our youth leaders have been trying to do some digging in the lives of our students. And I love what Jessica Ferguson put together last week. She met with our youth parents. We had about 100 youth parents down in the youth area. And she showed these groups of marbles, these three jars of marbles. Okay. Just imagine three jars of marbles. The marbles jars are all about this big. And they sat there on the table. And the first one was almost full. And the first one was almost full. And it represented the years 7th through 12th grade. One marble for every week that you would have a kid in your household. The second one was just 9th through 12th grade. And the last was just 11th and 12th grade. And it was to remind each and every one of us just how short a time we have with our children. Can you imagine that after freshman, sophomore, and junior year, you would look at your own kid and say, well, no fruit. We're done. Time to bring the axe. And yet some children experience that. Yet some children experience being cut down when they don't produce the fruit that parents expect. And they struggle because they don't meet expectations. One of the things that Rutgers also said is that some plants don't bear fruit in the first 3 or 4 years because they've been damaged. They've been damaged by frost. They've been damaged by over-pruning or by insects. And it takes longer for those fig trees to actually bear fruit. And that makes sense to me. That people who have had some hurt or some damage may take longer to mature, may take longer to actually bear fruit within their lives. And I am so thankful for the gardener. And the reason that I'm convinced in this passage that Jesus is the gardener is what happens after the crucifixion in the Gospel of John. I think it's the Gospel of John. It's been one of those days, right? Mary goes to the tomb, and when Mary goes to the tomb, she is looking for Jesus. She's looking for the body because here is a man who has excavated her life. Here's a man who has thrown Miracle-Gro into her life and nourished her and helped her to grow. And as he's done that, she goes and she wants to anoint the body. And when she gets there, she finds that the tomb is empty and she finds herself talking to someone and she mistakes him for the gardener. She mistakes him for the gardener. And when she mistakes him for the gardener, I have to believe that the gardener is Jesus in this passage. Because what he is able to do is he is willing to dig around our roots and help us to become stronger. That he is willing to pour a little extra Miracle-Gro and a little extra fertilizer onto our lives to be able to nurture us, to give us the chance to grow. So I really think this passage is not about worrying about what other people's fruit is. I think he's asking us the question about our own fruit. Are we producing fruit that is worthy of repentance? Are we producing fruit that is worthy of all that has been poured into us? And when you look at the trees of others, you may need to give them more of a break. In our backyard, we moved here 2 years ago, and I went out and we kind of surveyed the backyard, and in the back corner of our backyard was a huge stump. And I wondered what kind of tree it was. That's not my expertise. I didn't know exactly what kind of tree it was. But as we made our circle, walking our dog and getting to know the neighbors, David and Karen Hughes, who live behind us, they said, "Oh, we hate that the guy before you cut down your fig tree." I said, "Oh, that was a fig tree." They said it was a huge fig tree. It was so big that we could reach over the fence and grab fresh figs. And I thought, oh, what a waste. They cut down a fig tree that was amazing, that was so big that you could reach over the fence. But I went out there recently to look at that stump, and there was not a stump. This is what it looks like. And so I called one of my friends who is a horticulturist, and I said, "What's the deal? This thing was cut down to the stump." And she said, "Oh, but if you have great roots, if you have great roots, you can sustain damage and grow back." And so what I think Jesus is telling his people in this parable and is telling us today, we need to have great roots. We need to be able to spend some time down in the rich soil that God has planted us in so that even when the storms of life come, we are able to regrow and regenerate and trust in sure and certain hope of resurrection. I don't know if you saw it this week, but there was the Little League World Series, Oklahoma versus Texas. And it was the first inning of that game, and a young man named Isaiah, of all things, got up to the plate, and he was ready for the pitch to come in. And that little boy on the mound threw the ball as hard as he could, and it didn't go into the strike zone. That ball came and hit Isaiah in the helmet. Another inch towards the middle, it would have broken his jaw. And he landed on the ground. Take a look and see what happened. Maybe. Okay. Yeah, give me that computer. I'm ready. Or just, yeah, game on, come on. I am thankful about what happened next. That kid who was hit finally got up off the ground and he slowly made his way to first base. And when he got to first base, he stood there for a moment, and then he pulled his helmet off and started toward the mound. And the coach said, "If it had been any other kid, I would have been worried. But I wasn't worried about Isaiah because I knew him, and I knew that he was going to do something kind. For you see that the kid who was throwing the pitch, after he'd hit the other kid in the head, he couldn't get it together. He was standing there on the mound crying his eyes out because he didn't want to hurt anyone. He didn't want to bring pain into someone else's life. And he was so worried that the other kid was hurt. And he just stood there on the mound crying. And the kid from first base threw his helmet down. And he marched out and he just embraced the kid there on the pitcher's mound and said, "You're doing great. Keep going. You're doing great. Keep going." One of the officials from Oklahoma said, "We didn't win the game, but we won so much more that day. Because this is Little League, and we're not trying to create major leaguers. We're trying to create major league people." If you look for kindness, you'll begin to see it everywhere. If you start to share kindness, you'll begin to start seeing it everywhere. And I'm thankful that we are the people who follow in the footsteps of the Good Gardener, who are called to do the trial work that we need and to pour some manure on things. You know, sometimes people are pouring manure on us and we're not exactly sure what they're saying. And we need to dig deeper. We need to dig deeper as people who follow the gardener and to pour more nourishment on others, pour more encouragement into others. Because none of us really deserve a second chance. But we follow a gardener who gives us a second chance over and over and over again. I have to imagine the landowner comes back a year later and says to the gardener, "Well, I don't see any fruit." And the gardener will say once again to the landowner, "Give it one more year. Let me spend some more time digging. Let me spend some more time fertilizing. Let me spend some more time excavating and encouraging. I know that there'll be fruit someday. I know that there'll be fruit someday." The gardener looks at each and every one of us and says in the immortal words of Olivia Newton-John, "I love you. I honestly love you. And I'm thankful that we have a gardener that is hopefully devoted to our fruit. May we be devoted to bringing out the best in others by leaving our axes at home and doing the trial work and the fertilization that is needed. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, there are people that we struggle with. There are people who are not producing the fruit that we expect. Some of them are in our homes. Some of them are in our workplaces. Some of them are in our families. And we sometimes are quick to cut down with our words and with our deeds. Help us to be those that build up. Help us to be those who invest more deeply and pour into others so that your fruit might be born in such a way that the world is changed. In the book of Isaiah, you tell us that a little child shall lead them. And I'm thankful for a young man like Isaiah who, in response to his pain, went and offered kindness and encouragement. May we follow in the steps of the gardener and do the same. In your name we pray and give thanks for this time together. Amen.
As we reflect on the good news that we have received this morning, we have an opportunity to respond to God's grace by giving of ourselves. We can do that in several ways. You can give financially when the plates are passed or by scanning the QR code that will be on the screen or on the back of your bulletin. But this month, we here at DUMC are focusing on the impacts that we can make in our four primary mission areas. You've heard them several times already: food insecurity, at-risk kids, international missions, and transitional housing and homelessness. One of the ways your gifts makes a difference for at-risk kids is through the ministries of Murphy Harpst. It's a United Methodist Church agency. Murphy Harpst Children's Center is committed to meeting the needs of abused and neglected children and young people through their residential treatment placements in specialized foster care and community programs that serve at-risk kids, at-risk youth, and their families. Each year, your gifts Your giving helps DUMC support Murphy Harpst in its mission to provide safe and nurturing environments to kids in need, to those who are severely abused and neglected, children and teenagers, so that they can have a second chance, so that they can thrive and heal. There are so many ways that your giving can make a difference in our community and throughout the world. So let us continue our worship as we reflect on God's, as we reflect on the word that has been given today, and give a portion of what has been given to us back to God.
As we continue.
Come ye sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. Is Jesus ready? Stands to save you, full of pity, love and power.
I sing, come ye thirsty.
Come ye thirsty. Come and welcome God's free bounty. Glorify His true belief. True repentance, every grace that brings you nigh.
I will arise.
I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in His arms, and in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
See, come ye weary.
Come ye weary. Heavy laden. Lost in ruin by the fall. If you tarry till you're bent, you will never come at all.
I will arise.
I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in His arms, and in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
I will arise.
I will arise and go to Jesus. He will embrace me in His arms, and in the arms of my dear Savior. Oh, there are 10,000 charms. No, there are 10,000 charms. Oh, there are 10,000 charms.
Y'all have some homework this week. You need to Google John Daly hitting a tee, hitting a golf ball out of somebody's mouth. You need to Google the Oklahoma-Texas Little League and just see how a little child like Isaiah will lead them. You need to say hello to Ashley and Ron Sprinkle, who have been members of this church for 36 years, 32 years, your whole lives. And we're thankful for your faithfulness and hope that you will forgive our moments of missing some things today. Choose a trowel and not an axe. And the other thing you have to Google is Smyrna figs and the symbiotic relationship between the wasp and the Smyrna fig. You'll probably never eat a Smyrna fig again after you Google that. But that's a story for another day. I love what the gardener says to the landowner at the end of this passage. What he says at the end of this passage is this. Come back in a year, and if it bears fruit, well and good. And if not, you cut it down, because I'm not going to be a part of that. I'm not going to be a part of cutting it down. We are among those who build up and not those who cut down. And one of the ways we build up others is through food stock. There are a lot of these bags that we're going to fill, some 300,000 meals next Saturday. I hope that you'll come and to be able to take one shift and help us to feed hungry people in Nicaragua and make a difference in their lives. Friends, it's been a frustrating morning. Have you had some things like that fall apart in your life? Do you take the axe or the trowel? One will follow in the footsteps of the gardener. One does not. May we follow in the footsteps of the good gardener as we sing of God's mercy, God's grace, and God's peace. Go out and look for kindness and look for ways to make a difference. Amen.
O Holy Ghost, hold us together, bless us and keep us, and grant us peace. Wonderful Father, come shine upon us, show us favor and teach us love. Help us love justice and reach out our hands to comfort those in pain. Oh, Holy Ghost, hold us together, bless us and keep us. Shine upon us, show us favor in Jesus' name.
Amen. Go in peace.